few weeks ago, I watched Disney's latest entry into the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania. As I sat there watching, I thought to myself, man, this sucks. This is the worst movie I've ever seen. I left the theater impressed that what I just watched was so much of absolutely nothing. In addition, I was surprised to see people online were praising the movie. I had a surreal feeling. I know that 1 plus 1 equals 2, I knew that what I just watched was a bad movie. People often say art is subjective, and by that they mean art is to be judged relative to taste. But because everyone's taste is different, there's no way to determine whether someone's work is good or bad. But by that logic, how can anything be qualified objectively? If there's no such thing as a correct judgment, there cannot be any mistakes. If art is truly subjective, there's no difference between an award-winning film and scribbles on a paper. I propose that the quality of art, in this case film, can be qualified objectively. Now I know how that sounds. We're always told that the whole point of art is that it's subjective, and its interpretation is up to the viewer. So let's take this one step at a time. To start, we need to talk about the differences between the objective and subjective. According to Mr. Merriam-Webster, objective is defined as expressing or dealing with facts or conditions as perceived without distortion by personal feelings, prejudices, or intentions. So say you see a painting hanging in a museum. An objective statement would be, the painting is hanging on the wall. In contrast, subjective is defined as peculiar to a particular individual. So a subjective statement about the previously mentioned painting would be, I like this painting. The way in which we perceive the world around us and the objects that make up our existence is intrinsically subjective. For example, the sky might be blue on one side of the world, but orange on another. However, we still know that there are objective truths in the world. Naomi Island describes the idea of this perception as objective import, where it is in virtue of such imports that they put us in touch with the world of physical objects. Despite only having subjective perceptions of the objective world, I believe that humans can create our own objective standards for which to judge the world of artistic expression. In the same way we've created artificial intelligence, we'll call this artificial objectivity. In simpler terms, the world provided to us is objective, so a world in which we create, we decide the objective standards. But how do we collectively decide these standards, you might ask? There are two visual theories which I believe to accurately describe the exchange between filmmaker and spectator. These are the gaze and framing theories. The theory of the gaze describes the way in which spectators view a visual medium. In The Real Gaze, film theory after Lacan, Todd McGowan describes the gaze as a function of the imaginary, the key to the imaginary deception that takes place in the cinema. None of what happens in films is real, excluding what happens in documentary. Nonetheless, when watching a film, we consciously forget about the idea that these ideas and stories presented are fabricated by a production team. In Human Strive for Happiness, we gain pleasure in pieces that embody elements absent from our lives. McGowan writes, through their manipulation of the gaze, films produce the space in which spectators can insert themselves. Simply put, the gaze is a tool used for finding these pieces in the visual world. Despite our differences, we're all human. We share similar desires and tastes. The gaze theory proves that, and the framing theory utilizes it. First articulated in Irving Goffman's 1974 book, Frame Analysis, an essay on the organization of experience, framing is the idea that the way audiences perceive information is controlled by those who present it. While one thing may momentarily appear to be what is really going on, in fact what is actually happening is plainly a joke, or a dream, or an accident, or a mistake, or a misunderstanding, or a deception, or a theatrical performance. The description of framing lends itself perfectly to the idea that specific film techniques can be used to create situations in which audiences lose themselves in the stories far better than others. The audience uses the gaze to find things they relate to or resonate with, and filmmakers will use framing in order to present their films in a way in which will satisfy the audience's gaze the most. These two theories prove the idea that as humans, we share the same standards for what will please us. Objective truths about the world are usually about as simple as saying, that tree is over there. So when it comes to watching a movie, there is no other way to verify a performance other than watching the scene. If others agree, that of course strengthens our sense of certainty. But those others can only arrive at their decision by the same direct method as ourselves. Take grammar, for instance. The idea that sentences are punctuated by periods, question marks, or exclamation points does not exist in the natural world. These truths have developed as a result of humans agreeing on their validity. We create these ideas, and so, we develop the rules for them. In similar fashion, Filmmakers use techniques that have proven over the course of film and writing history to captivate audiences and convince them of these imaginary worlds.
Since the invention of the motion picture in 1878, what filmmakers learned the medium of film could do best was to tell stories to mass audiences. D.W. Griffith, director of the pioneering, yet controversial film, The Birth of a Nation, was the first to combine the ideas of alternating shots and set pieces into one cohesive story, leading to what could be called film grammar. The methods used to make meaningful storytelling have evolved over the course of time and throughout the world through different artistic movements. However, the effects these methods achieve still hold true. To show this best, we're going to look at a few examples. We'll start with a good movie. Everything, Everywhere, All at Once.
Also a huge spoiler warning.
This movie utilizes every element of film to deliver the most authentic and emotional story I've ever seen. In the film, we follow the Wang family's journey as they reflect on the value of their relationships in perspective with an infinite multiverse. Evelyn Wang, our protagonist, wishes her life turned out differently, especially after learning that she is the worst version of herself that exists. Our antagonist, Joy Wang, has seen every possible universe and version of herself, and as a result, finds the existence of life meaningless. Over the course of the movie, they both learn that meaning is made by putting in those you love. You could be anything else, but you are anything else. You are what you are, and that's what makes you special. With the budget of $14.3 million and a VFX team of 9 people, the film would go on to win the Best Picture and 6 other Oscars at the 95th Academy Awards. The themes are clear, the story is enthralling, the characters change and develop, and it's all covered under its beautiful coat of visual effects. Now for a bad movie. We're going to talk about the previously mentioned Ant-Man and the Wasp, Quantumania.
Spoilers for this one too, but it sucks, so it doesn't matter.
The plot follows Ant-Man and his family when they are sucked into the quantum realm because of a device built by Cassie Lang, Ant-Man's daughter. Upon entering, they learn of an evil tyrant named Kang who wishes to escape the quantum realm and conquer the universe. They explore, meeting inhabitants of the quantum realm, and Kang forces Ant-Man to recover his exit key by threatening his daughter. In the end, they stop Kang and escape with no consequences other than a cryptic warning that more Kangs are coming in future movies. Throughout the movie, none of the characters change in any meaningful way. The altruistic Cassie Lang acts as a motivation for her father, Scott Lang. The movie tries to say that Scott learns the importance of helping those in need from his daughter's actions, but he already knows those things. He's been a superhero for 4 movies now. Janet Van Dyne learns that she shouldn't lie and that she should trust her family, I guess, but that all happens within 5 minutes. Hope, better known as the Wasp, half of the title, goes through no changes. Hank Pym goes through no changes. Kang the Conqueror, the primary antagonist, does not change. This movie has a budget of over $200 million, and it looks like garbage. Most of the sets are either green screen or the virtual space known as the Volume, but it creates a divide between the characters and the world they are supposed to be traversing. Marvel movies are famous for beginning production before writing a concept work is finished, and this movie is no exception. In fact, this movie had its conclusion reshot a month before release. A month! This movie is the embodiment of poor planning, lazy writing, and a complete lack of passion for filmmaking. These movies are tangible proof that film and art can be objective. Now, I'd like to clarify a few things. Because of the numerous elements that make up film, and the quality that may vary between them, it will be unrealistic to place every single movie into only either completely good or completely bad. Taking into account these differences, rating movies on a scale of 1 to 10 is the most effective way to concisely state a movie's quality. That also isn't to say that a movie considered good cannot have weak elements, or vice versa. For example, the movie Tron Legacy is a mostly generic story quest. Dude enters a world and must learn the rules of said world in order to escape. However, Tron is elevated because of its excellent presentation. Its sound design, visuals, and setting put it apart and push forward the generic story in a way never seen before. I'd also like to clarify that there's nothing necessarily wrong with enjoying bad movies. One of the largest reasons people go to see movies is to act as a distraction from their everyday lives. And while movies considered good are so because they do an excellent job of this, that isn't to say that audience members still can't enjoy simpler storytelling and visuals. For example, I love the Transformers movies. I will admit that the storytelling is poor, the writing's bad, acting's bad, everything pretty much sucks in those movies. However, when I go to see a Transformers movie, it's not because I'm there for good writing, it's because I want to see the giant CG robots beating the shit out of each other. You feel me? Now, in case you got a little confused during all that, understandable, I want to summarize things for you. The way you feel about art and the way you let it impact you is subjective. I'm not trying to tell you what you cannot enjoy. Please watch what you want to watch. However, I'm not trying to say that film cannot be qualified objectively. Just like humans have developed systems like grammar and its objective laws, the invention of film has come with its own parameters for the objective review of quality. Based on the gaze and the idea that all humans fundamentally derive pleasure from the same things, filmmakers are able to frame their movies in a way that could be qualified as good or bad. The existence of writing classes and award shows further prove the idea that there's a right and wrong way to make movies. Now, of course, people might argue that because we all have different preferences, we'll never agree on what can be artificially objective. But really, there is just no way to see yet. Humans still have a long way to go, and, you know, it's going to be a while before we figure out all the answers to these things. It's okay for art to be bad, and it's okay to enjoy what you want to enjoy. What matters is, one way or another, we learn from it. We keep moving forward onto better things. Thank you. Hey everybody, it's me, Shatton. This is not a normal video. This is made for a college class of mine, but I really enjoyed making it, and I hope you enjoyed watching it. I hope it turns out real cool. This is me talking after the video came out. Isn't that, like, wild? I want to thank a few people. First of all, my cameraman, Rennie, come out here and say hello. You want to plug anything?
Hi. Cool. Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom.
Hey, Editing Sean here. I honest to God couldn't think of what to say here, so thanks for watching.
Yeah, that's it. See ya.